Welcome back. I'm still Taylor, and let's keep exploring the world of biology. So far, we've unpacked that cells are the basic unit of all life, and explored different types of cells, including really zooming into plant and animal eukaryotic cells. Today, we're going to focus on our human bodies. Our jumping-off question for today is, how do cells work together in my body? In this lesson, our goals are to understand first the benefits of an organism being made of lots of cells, second, how we know cells work together in our bodies, and third, how cells work together in our bodies. If you're following along in the guided notes, pause the video and jot down what you think right now before we unpack these ideas. As humans, are we multicellular or unicellular organisms? As we've discussed in previous lessons, humans, as well as all other animals, plants, and fungi, are multicellular organisms made up of lots of eukaryotic cells. Why do you think we're multicellular organisms? What advantages do you think there are to being multicellular? If you're following along in the guided notes, pause the video again and jot down your thoughts. Unicellular organisms are, of course, just one cell each. They can only perform functions on a very small scale. Multicellular organisms have systems of cells that work together to complete complex tasks. And those systems of cells even work together, allowing the organism to function on a much larger scale. Consider the difference between a single athlete and a team. One athlete can function and perform like a single cell, but a team of athletes can do far more by working together. Fun fact, an average adult human is built of at least 37 trillion cells, but some estimates are even as large as 100 trillion cells. Let's explore how these cells interact to carry out complex functions. Another benefit of being a multicellular organism is that individual cells can become specialized for particular functions. Humans have around 200 different types of cells, including different types of blood cells, muscle cells, and nerve cells. Within humans and other multicellular organisms, we observe cells organized into tissues. We have four basic types of tissues, each composed of tons of cells of different types: epithelial, connective, muscle, and nerve tissue. Epithelial tissue is sheet-like, covering and protecting cells and tissues beneath them. The visible layer of our skin is epithelial tissue that is built of different types of skin cells. Connective tissue joins together and supports parts of the body. Bone is an example of connective tissue that is built of various types of bone cells, along with hard calcium-full material produced by those cells. Muscle tissue moves the body inside and out. Skeletal muscle tissue is connected to bone to move it, and also moves skin related to bone, while cardiac muscle keeps the heart pumping 24/7. Finally, nerve tissue carries the electrical signals that allow our brain to work and allow information to be sent throughout our body. Nerve tissue makes up the brain, spinal cord, and all the nerves throughout our body. Just as cells form tissues, we observe these tissues cooperating together as organs. Most human organs contain all four types of tissues. The small intestine is a great example. The most internal part of the small intestine that actually comes in contact with food it processes is made of epithelial tissue. The next layer of the organ is connective tissues, followed by layers of both smooth muscle tissue and nerve tissue. The epithelial tissue allows the organ to absorb nutrients from the food. The connective tissue protects and supports the organ and its functions. The muscle tissue allows the organ to move food forward, and the nerve tissue allows the organ to communicate with the brain. All other organs throughout our body are built of layers of tissues that allow them to function as well. In future lessons, we'll discuss lots of other organs in detail. Amazingly, the organization within our bodies doesn't stop there. Organs, including the small intestine, form organ systems, also called body systems, with unified purposes. To continue our example, the small intestine is part of the digestive system, which processes all the food we eat, absorbing the nutrients, processing the energy, and moving forward the wastes. Our bodies have several other body systems, including our circulatory system, which circulates our blood, our nervous system that allows us to think and act, and our respiratory system that allows us to breathe. In future lessons, we'll dive deeper into these and other body systems. All of these levels of organization and cooperation, cells, tissues, organs, and organ or body systems collectively form our bodies. All of these systems interact and communicate to create a working, healthy body that eats, breathes, thinks, moves, and so many other things. Let's wrap this lesson by returning to our jumping-off question and learning goals. If you are following along in the guided notes, pause the video and reflect on what we've unpacked to respond to these sentence stems. The benefits of being made of lots of cells are that we can function on a much, much larger scale than unicellular organisms. Individual cells can become specialized to different functions, and systems of cells can accomplish much more complex tasks than individual cells. We know cells work together in our bodies because we observe cells organizing into groups of tissues and even higher levels of organization to perform functions together. Cells work together by organizing into tissues, which organize into organs, which organize into organ or body systems, which all make up a body. Yay! Way to learn stuff! Now, go refine and test your understanding of these cell biology concepts with the practice questions and PDF. And, coming up, we'll dive deeper into our human body systems. Hey, hey.